فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The reason they were harming him is because he stood up to call to the good and to prohibit the evil. The Sheikh used to prohibit shirk, dalalat and bid'ah. He used to call to the following of the sunnah and the following of the textual evidences. And so they harmed him excessively, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So what the Sheikh did was, when the harm became a lot, the Sheikh moved from Huraymila and he went back to his place of birth, Uyayna. So the Sheikh, rahimahullah, he came to Uyayna, and at that time he was ready to go to Uyayna because the man who his father had a conflict with in Uyayna had died, and another man had taken over Uyayna. His name was Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar. Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar was the man who now took over, Uyayna. And Uthman ibn Nasir كان محبا للشيخ. He used to love Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab excessively. And so now he became in charge of Uyayna. So he requested for the Sheikh to come. He said, please come, live in where you're born. This is your land of birth. So the Sheikh did go there. And the Sheikh, rahimahullah, he busied himself in educating and studying. He would nurture himself in knowledge, in increasing knowledge. And he would also make sure that he educated those who were around him. Then the Shaykh, rahimahullah, it became clear to him, أن الحجة قد أقيمت, that the proof has been established on the people, and that the knowledge has been spread. That the knowledge has what? Has been spread. And that ignorance has been removed from the people. The Shaykh has now seen that he has established a proof against the people. For years he's been teaching them now. All of this with the virtue and the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, after that, with the grace of the Shaykh's da'wah himself as well. The Shaykh now, he commanded with the alliance of Uthman ibn Muammar, who was the leader of Uyayna. They both commanded that the mazahir al-shirk, that these symbols of shirk, these shrines that are in Uyayna, the 17 trees, all of them should be destroyed. فَقُطِعَتْ وَأُزِيلَتْ تِلْكَ الْآثَارِ. All of the trees were cut. All of the signs and the symbols of shirk that were showing, all of them got destroyed. When the story and the information reached the people, it was a state of shock to the people. But the Sheikh didn't busy himself with what the Bunayat al-Tariq, or the people on the streets, are saying. He busied himself with knowledge. He busied himself with the athar and the mawaqif al-Sahaba, and that which the Prophet was upon. So the Sheikh, rahimahullah, he's carried on still educating the people, still spreading knowledge. So the people were hearing about him. And that Uyayna now has a circle of knowledge where the people are learning Tawheed and Aqeedah Sahiha. So the people started to come to Uyayna. His reputation was growing. But the leading other tribes around Uyayna were getting worried of what's happening in Uyayna. So threats and warnings were being sent to the leader of Uyayna, to Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar. Threats were being thrown at him. And they requested from the Sheikh, they requested that this issue become stopped. This ridiculous things that are being done, as they refer to it as, should be brought to a halt and should be stopped. The Sheikh told Uthman ibn Muammar, be patient. He told him, Allah is with those who are patient. Endurance is needed from you. And if you do carry on being patient, Allah is going to give you the upper hand. After that, the Shaykh Uthman ibn Muammar accepted it. And he chose to take patience. And he let the Shaykh spread his knowledge. Then the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he went towards the biggest shrine in Jaziratul Arab. The biggest shrine in the Arabian Peninsula. This was what? The Qubba of what? Of Zayd ibn al-Khattab. As we mentioned in Jumeirah. The Shaykh went there to destroy it. Uthman ibn Muammar, he sent with the Shaykh 600 horsemen. 600 Faris. He gave him 600 horsemen. He said, take them with you. So the people heard that the Shaykh is going to the biggest shrine in the whole of Jaziratul Arab. And the Shaykh is going to destroy it. So what did they think that was going to happen? They thought what was going to happen to him is what happened to Abraha. That Allah is going to send on Muhammad Abdul Wahab, أرسل عليهم طيرا أبابيل ترميهم بحجارة من سجيل فجعلهم كعصف مأكول. They thought Allah is going to send rocks from the sky on Muhammad Abdul Wahab because he's destroying the biggest shrine. And that Allah is going to bring an end to him. And they believe that the earth is going to swallow him. As it's the what? كما هي عادة الشرك والضلال. As it's the norms of the people of shirk and the people of disguidance who are worshipping besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Shaykh rahimahullah, he did destroy the shrine. And no birds came down on the Shaykh. And no earth swallowed him. Alayhi rahmatullah. But what did happen was, this had a waqa. This had a excessive, it shook Jaziratul Arab. It made a big noise in Arabian Peninsula, what he just did. And now, the warnings and the threats that were sent to the leader of Uyayna was excessive. The leaders of the tribes were sitting with Uthman ibn Muammar. The leader of Ihsa, he had actually, he sent a letter to Muhammad, Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar. He sent a letter to him and he was telling him to kick out Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. And he said to him, if you do not get rid of him, and then you're gonna, this is going to bring you an end. And the leader of Ahsa, there was a relationship between him and Bayna Uthmaniyin. And the leader of Ahsa, his land was considered as what? It was one of the richest of all of them. It was one of the Dawlatul Ghaniya. Very rich. He had a lot of khayrat. Ala kulli hal, Uthman ibn Muammar, he showed patience. Sheikh said, be patient. Fabaqiya ala da'wati, Sheikh remained upon. Uthman ibn Muammar said, okay, I'll take this one again. And he said, I'll be patient with you, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. So what happened was, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala carried on his da'wah. A woman came to the Shaykh. And she acknowledged that she committed zina. فَعَتَرَفَتْ بِالزِّنَا. She acknowledged and she admitted that she fell into zina. And she was very close to the leaders of the neighboring areas of Uyayna. She had very close relationship with the neighboring leaders. But she acknowledged that she committed zina. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he established on her haddu zina. Established on her haddu zina. After she acknowledged it four times. This now made the matters very big for the Shaykh. Rahimahullah wa rahmatan wasa. This is a woman who's known. So when the Shaykh rahimahullah did this, Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar, letters now would not stop coming to him. They commanded him to kick out the Shaykh, and this time they said to him things that they haven't said to him before, which is, if you don't do that, وَإِلَّا غَزَوْتُكَ بِجَمِيعِ قَبِيلَتِي, my whole tribe will come and wage war against you. This matter is war. So they requested that the Shaykh be brought to them. This time they didn't want the Shaykh to get kicked out of Uyayna, but the Shaykh be what? Bring him to me. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab sat with Uthman ibn Mu'ammar, he said, be patient. Uthman ibn Mu'ammar said, not this time, Muhammad. Muhammad, I can't do it now. بَلَغَ السَّيْلُ الزُّبَى The matters have reached a high level. I can't be. But there is one favor I can do for you. I will not take you to them. And I will not put you in their hands. I won't. Run and get away from the city. Leave Uyayna. The Sheikh sat with him and said, no, you're not looking at things correctly. These things are going to happen. Pressure is going to come. Hardship will come. You will go through all of that. But be patient. He said, no. Leave Uyayna. So the Sheikh rahimahullah did not know where to go. This is his place of birth. This is where he grew. This is where his tribe is from. This is his people. The Sheikh didn't know what to do. He doesn't know where to go. The Sheikh, he left walking. خَرَجَ مَاشِيًا عَلَىٰ قَدَمَيْهِ The Sheikh left walking on his foot. لَا يَدْرِ إِلَىٰ أَيْنَ يَذْهَبُ He didn't know where to go. He doesn't know where to go to. He's lost of ideas. Finally, it came to his mind, if he goes to Dir'iyah, and Dir'iyah at that time, the Sheikh, reason why he chose it was because some of his students were there. Some of his students were there. And the Sheikh, Dir'iyah at that time, as it looked, was a very small place. All of Dir'iyah had was 40 houses. Only 40 houses. Dir'iyah. The leader of Dir'iyah is Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud is the leader of Dir'iyah. What do you realize? That the Arabian Peninsula is what now? It's in tribes now. It's run by tribes. Tribal leaders are running it. Sheikh Rahimahullah, he came and he stayed in the house of his students. He stayed there, Rahimahullah. As soon as he entered Dir'iyah, he went and he stayed with his students. And this student of his that he went to was a very young student. Ahmed As-Suwaylim was a very young individual. He was very young. The Sheikh couldn't find anyone else that he could actually go and stay with. Amir Dir'iyah, the leader of Dir'iyah, his wife was a very righteous woman. Zawjatuhu, his wife, was Imra'a Saliha. She was a very righteous woman. Wakan Abnuhu, the son of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, was who? Abdul Aziz. Abdul Aziz was what? The son of who? Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. And Abdul Aziz, who is the son of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, also met Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab and he took knowledge from him. And he studied from him. And he grew knowledge from him. In Uyayna. He went there, Abdul Aziz, and he studied with Muhammad ibn Abdul before. So the wife of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud knew of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. So when he came, when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab came to Dir'iyah, the wife of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said to her husband, Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, she said to him, Abshir, God tidings. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said to her, Khayr basharikil Allahu bil Jannah. Khayr, may Allah give you the glad tidings of Jannah. What is it that you're, in other words, what is it that you're telling me to his wife? Qalat, she said, Abshir, bi ghanima. Glad tidings to a ghanima, spoils of war. Saqaha Allahu ilayka. Allah has brought this to you. He's brought it to you. You don't have to fight for it. It's ghanima, you don't fight for it. It came to you. فَقَالَ مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ سُعُودِ said, وَمَا هِيَ What is this? قَالَ She said, دَاعِيَة A caller. يَدْعُو إِلَىٰ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ He calls to the book of Allah. وَإِلَىٰ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ He calls to the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. يَدْعُو إِلَىٰ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ قُمْ فَانْصُرْ Stand up, Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. Give this man victory. She was praising Muhammad Abdul Wahab. And she was requesting from her husband to give victory to this man. So the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said, no problem. Let him come to me. Tell him to come to me. Then she said to him, la, no. The wife of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said, no. Anta tadhabu ilayhi. You're going to go to him. Hatta ya'lamu an-nas, so the people can know you are mukrimun lahu, that you're a person who is honoring the Shaykh. Wa anna al-ilma yu'ta wa la ya'ti, and that people should go to knowledge and knowledge doesn't come. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud stood up. He's the leader. Pause and stop here. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, both times, did he go into the palaces of the leaders? Did he do elections? Did he in any way start with the leaders? Or did Uthman ibn Muammar call him to come from Huraymila to Uyayna? Did he not ask him to do it? Did he not? When he came to Dir'iyah, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, did he even go to the leader? He went to his student. Who came to who? The leader came to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. He didn't go to the doors of the leaders. He didn't engage himself into politics. This is a tariqah salafiyya. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, she came and she knocked on his house. Sorry, he knocked on his house. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud knocked on his house. When he entered the house, the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he saw Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. He asked him to open his hand. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud requested from Muhammad Abdul Wahhab to open his palm. And he opened his palm and he said to the Shaykh, Abshir bis Nasri. Glad tidings for victory, inshaAllah ta'ala. Abshir bil iwa'i. Remember, you're going to get shelter and aid from us. Abshir bi kada. Abshir bi kada. Glad tidings for this. Promising the Shaykh so much. And the Shaykh then said to him, Wa anta Abshir bil izz. As for you, Muhammad Abdul Wahhab said to him in response, and as for you, glad tiding of honor that Allah is going to bring you. والتمكين والظفر. Allah is going to make you grounded on this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to aid you. فَمَا نَصَرَ أَحَدٌ دِينَ اللَّهِ. No one has ever given victory to the religion of Allah إِلَّا نَصَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, except Allah will give victory to them. Allahu Akbar. The Shaykh said, no one gives victory to what? The religion of Allah, except Allah will give victory to them. We don't look for victory for ourselves. We look for victory and honoring the what? The religion. That will then allow us to gain victory from it. Are we all together? Where did the Shaykh take from this? إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ, if you give victory to Allah's religion, and you support and you aid and you stand up for Allah's religion, يَنْصُرْكُمْ, Allah will make you and give you and solidify you on this earth. وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ, and your foot will be grounded on this earth. Then the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, but I have two conditions I want to stipulate. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said, what are the two conditions? He said, the two conditions are, أَخْشَى, I am scared. إِنْ أَظْهَرَكَ اللَّهِ, if Allah makes you apparent on this earth, and Allah makes you known, Allah gives you the upper hand, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, Allah gives you victory, and تَتُرُكَنَا, that you're going to leave us. وَتَرْجِعْ إِلَىٰ بَلَدِكَ, you're going to go back to your land, عُيَيْنَا, because that's where you're from, that's your people. As Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said, as for this, I promise I will not do that. I will not leave you guys. He said, what is the second condition then? He said, the second one is, I take from the people of Dir'iyah dara'ib. I tax them. I tax the people of what? I tax the people of the people of Dir'iyah. I tax them. And of course, these taxes are what? They're not permissible, shara'an. They're not the zakat. This is not the zakat. After the zakat, he's taking tax from them. He said, could you allow me to take that? Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he said to him in response of that, no. Allahu Akbar. He said, no, I won't. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to suffice you with the money that you're going to get, inshallah ta'ala. What Allah is going to bring you is going to be far better than the tax that you're taking. Today, a da'i would say that there's no problem for this country and this constitution to judge by democracy. There's no problem, let them do it. We don't mind them being a democratical country. Here, Muhammad ibn Abdullah is just saying, forget democracy as a whole system. You are not even allowed to, he wouldn't even agree to just take an extra tax from the people. He refused that. So Allah is going to give you better. No compromising on his deen. Alayhi rahmatullah. And you have to realize, at that particular time, the Shaykh just walked from Uyayna by foot. He doesn't know where to go, rahimahullah. Everyone is looking for him. He's being looked for. The Shaykh, Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, they're hunting him down. They're looking for him. Here he's with Muhammad ibn Saud. He's got the opportunity of getting his heart, but he still has principles, the deen, which is that this will not happen. He said, أَمَّا هَذِهِ فَلَا. This is what you're asking for, which is the dharaib. No. وَسَيُغْنِيكَ اللَّهُ. Allah will suffice you, Muhammad ibn Saud. And مِنْ فَضْلِهِ, Allah is going to suffice you with His virtue and His grace. وَسَيَفْتَحُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَىٰ قَرْيَتِكَ. Allah is going to open for you, and Allah is going to open for the people of your village. This little qariya, Allah is going to make it something else. وَبِالْفِعْلِ, وَاللَّهِ, without a doubt, كَمَّتِ الْبَيْعَةِ. Bay'ah, they gave each other. This is how it happened. This is what we want. This is how we want honor to be brought back, to restored. Look what the Shaykh did. Did he then say to Muhammad Saud, I'm going to sit in your assemblies, I'm going to see when you meet the tribal leaders, and I have to be part of the... Did he say that? La. As soon as that bay'ah took place, and they both agreed, the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he asked, where is the masjid? 40 houses, they only had one masjid in Dir'iya. So where's the masjid? They pointed to him, they said, that's the masjid. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he went to the masjid. He went to the masjid, he sat down and he started classes. Nothing after that. Right after the bay'ah, the Shaykh sat in the masjid and he started to do durus. At-tasfiyah wa-tarbiyah, educating the people. Speaking to them about at-tawheed. The Shaykh had halaqat, rahimahullah. He would have a halaqa come and the halaqa would go. Straight after the halaqa, there's another halaqa coming in. They would go, the Shaykh is still teaching. People will come, groups after groups, in numbers. They would keep coming and coming and coming and coming. He would have a halaqa in tafsir, halaqa in hadith, halaqa in fiqh, halaqa in aqidah, halaqa in sunnah. All of that Shaykh had, rahimahullah ta'ala. When the people heard this, they started to whisper, you know what's happening? There's classes going on over there. This was taking place. There's a lot of khair happening. Ya ayyuhal qawm, we're sleeping, let's get up, let's go. People were coming from different cities and different towns and different areas. They were coming. They were coming to the Shaykh, rahimahullah. The students, they filled up Dir'iyah. They filled it up until Dir'iyah became overcrowded. It became overcrowded that the Shaykh had to beg the 40 houses in Dir'iyah to open their balconies or their front porch. If they can let the students sit inside there, because the masjid became crowded. The people were sitting in the middle of the road. The people were going into the houses of the people. He asked the people, if you have an extra room, allow your brother and your sister, your brothers and the students of knowledge to come and sleep and live there. The Shaykh rahimahullah, the matters became great in Dir'iyah. Good and blossom. The da'wah was spreading. The people coming in number. The Sheikh rahimahullah realized with knowledge what is that the Sheikh is getting rid of ignorance. Ilm comes when the light of ilm of Tawheed and Sunnah comes, the people have been taken out of the darknesses that they're upon. So the Sheikh rahimahullah, he has the permission and the support of Muhammad ibn Saud. So the Sheikh rahimahullah, he stood up to remove and to get rid of Mazahir al-Shirk, the still remaining symbols of a shirk, get rid of them, and to destroy them. But the Sheikh rahimahullah, his job is to educate and teach the people. The people are growing in number, and the people are becoming large in amount. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Muhammad ibn Saud, on the other hand, he is doing what would any leader do? He would have to accommodate these people. So what he did was, he started to set contracts with the neighboring tribes, making sure they don't transgress on him. Because he knows he wants to benefit from this da'wah. This da'wah needs to be left alone. So Muhammad ibn Saud was doing ahlaf, contracts and agreements with neighboring tribal leaders, saying, leave us alone and we'll leave you guys alone. And they were signing those contracts with him. They were what? They were signing those contracts with Muhammad ibn Saud. And this was given the opportunity to who? To Muhammad ibn Saud to what? To spread Tawheed and call to Sunnah. This Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he now has students who are solid, strong, mentally and physically they are strong. What united them is Tawheed and Iman. They did not unite together on what? They did not unite upon tribalism. No, not even nationalism. They united upon Nusratul Kitab, giving victory to the Kitab of Allah and the Sunnah. And so what happened was, the people in which Muhammad ibn Saud, he signed the ahlaf with and the agreements with, they lied. Some of them broke the contract. And they started to want to wage war against Muhammad ibn Saud. So he sat down and he consulted, Muhammad ibn Saud consulted Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. How should matters be dealt with? Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said, we will not allow anyone to transgress on us. We will defend ourselves. So the first fight that started between Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and Muhammad ibn Saud and those neighboring other tribes was when the year was 1159. And as I said before, the reason why this battle took place was ghadar, deception that came from those who signed with Muhammad ibn Saud. They deceived him. Like the leader of Riyadh. He lied and he deceived Muhammad ibn Saud. His name was Daham ibn Dawas. He was the first person who had broke the contract. He came and he waged war on the Sheikh. The Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab and also Muhammad ibn Saud. Allah gave the upper hand to Muhammad Abdul Wahhab and his children, and he gave it to Muhammad ibn Saud. The Sheikh rahimahullah ta'ala, he carried on his da'wah. He didn't busy himself too much with that. He carried on. The Sheikh was teaching even as the battles were happening. The classes were going on. The schedules would not stop. The durus would not stop. The Sheikh was still teaching them Tawheed. He was teaching them Sunan. The Sheikh was still sending letters to the leaders of all the tribe, the scholars. He was sending letters to them. He was talking to them about the most important matters in which every prophet was sent to. And that was what? At-Tawheed. Until Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab sent a letter to the leader of Mecca. And Mecca at that time, the person who was in charge was called Sharif of Mecca. He was called the Sharif of Mecca. The Sheikh met him. And others also went and visited him. Hamad ibn Nasir ibn Mu'ammar, who was one of the students of the Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Rather, he's from one of the biggest students of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. He went and he met the Sharif of Mecca. And this was a delegation sent by Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab to the Sharif of Mecca. When the Sharif of Mecca sat with them and they debated about these matters of Tawheed, so Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab's issue was writing letters, and he was also sending students to these people, saying, discuss with these scholars, discuss with these people shirk that's happening and that they're silent about. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, they sat down with him, they sat down with the Sharif of Mecca, Hamad ibn Nasir, and the students. They've debated him. Lakin, all of Hijaz is Mecca, Medina, Jeddah, Ta'if, all of those places, they gave a fatwa that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and his grandchildren are dhullal, misguided individuals. They are kuffar, they are disbelievers, and that the Shaykh himself is a kafir, and that the Shaykh himself is a misguided individual. And what they did was they killed those who came with Hamad ibn Nasir. They killed them. They took them as spoils of war. And they banned the children of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab and anyone who came from Najd. They banned them. They put a cross on them. Until 50 years, Hajj was prohibited and it was banned from the people of Najd. No one could come from there. No Hajj, a person of Hajj, can come from Najd. And this was a ban that was placed by the Sharif of Mecca. And then the next Sharif of Mecca came. And then another one came after that. Each Sharif of Mecca, when he dies, the other one comes. Until the next one, after 50 years, the Sharif removed the ban and he allowed them to come. This shows you that the Sheikh was harmed. His own students were killed. He was also, fatwa was given. Sharif Mecca had somebody, he was somebody who had great influence and he had a very strong tie with the Dawla Uthmaniyya. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, harm was shown to him.